Number 40 on our list, lot number 127. Kind of an odd duck and a rare duck, but a beautiful, beautiful gun nevertheless. Some Marston percussion breech loading rifle. One of only approximately 300 that were manufactured, without question the finest example known. And historically speaking, you have to put it into this transitional period. We're trying to figure out, look at volcanics, of the breech loading mechanism, which was kind of the anomaly everyone's trying to solve. Well, the Marston is very much in that discussion. Aside from how it functions, I want to look at it from an art object perspective, because this thing is utterly sensational. One, I want to talk about the combination of finishes. You have brown barrel blued frame, bird's eye maple stock. So we can see the transition or the combination of finishes that exist. I want to roll the gun because I want to talk about, look at the blue on the rear sight. Two gold bands at the back of the barrel. LD Nimshki, I don't want to say at his finest, but some of his best. We have this scene very well and very prominent in the pull book, in the smoke pull book or the ink pull book in Nimshki's own book, but no doubt a masterpiece by him. Let's talk about condition. Look at the case hardening here on the lever. Out of this world. I'll flip it so you can see the other side, but really more the same. Again, the brown, the blue, the beautiful bird's eye maple with the cheek piece. I want you to see the case hardening here on the butt plate itself. These screws are still indexed, as you can see. It's as good as it gets for what it is. It is the best of the best for what it is, and it fits in, and it fits in at a great time, kind of that transitional time. Again, look at volcanics, look at that early, trying to find out that breech loading mechanism, percussion breech loader, but as an art object, as good as it gets, some of LD Nimshki's best work, and it's the preservation of condition. Super, super rare. Number 40 on our list, number 127 in your catalogs. Number 39 on our list, lot number 259 in your catalogs. We're talking about the Dr. Klaz collection, specifically his phenomenal sub-collection of factory engraved Smith & Wessons. And what we have here is an extremely important gun, a factory engraved Gustav Jung, number 3 American second model. Now, unfortunately, due to ineptitude by the head curator who's responsible for writing factory letters for Smith & Wessons, we're unable to get this gun properly documented, just like its mates. Guns before it and guns after it, but this is in a very important serial number range, 7500 range. You know, these guns not only toured the world, but they toured the world, and they were the keystone of the Smith & Wesson display that toured the world. We're talking Moscow, Vienna, most importantly, the 1876 Centennial Exhibition in Philadelphia. The gun that comes before it and the gun that comes after it, somehow letter as being a part of both those, and again, through lack of effort or alternative motives, we can't get the proper documentation on this gun to letter, but it certainly so is. It is Gustav Jung at its absolute finest. Two-tone, nickel blue, and no doubt, again, part of those exhibitions. Beautiful carved ivory grips on both sides. I mean, two different variations. You have a patriotic eagle, two different variations of the patriotic eagle itself. A wreath, which is the seal of the state of Connecticut, another eagle on this side, but a two-tone gun, beautiful gun, Gustav Jung at his absolute finest, an exhibition revolver, again, courtesy of the Klaz collection. And again, it's hard to articulate and hard to properly say. You have to understand those guns that have sold or that are numbered before and after it have brought six figures. And again, through a lack of proper lettering by the curator, we can't have that here, but the gun should stand on its own. It's phenomenal. It's extremely rare. It's Gustav Jung at its finest. We're proud to have it. Of course, it's good enough for Dr. Klaz's collection. It's good enough for yours. Number 39 on our list, lot number 259 in your catalogs. Number 38 on our list is lot number 59. It proudly represents the John Fox collection. And we'll talk a little bit more about John Fox a little later on. Of course, we've introduced you to the Fox collection last auction, part one of the John Fox collection, a celebration of the American West. And Mr. Fox's collection is very nuanced, but it's also very spread out. There's sub-collections within it, but it is very much a celebration of the American West. But it can't really be pigeonholed into one thing or another, and I think this gun really emphasizes that to a large degree, because pound for pound for rarity and pound for price point, counting down the top 50 in the sale, listen, if I pick the top 50 most expensive guns on this list, or if I only did six-figure guns, it would almost be half of this list. So that's not the intention of this top 50. It's through my eyes what I think that the best top 50 guns are. Everyone's going to come up with a different answer, but as a price point gun and as a rare gun, that's why I love this Lightning, and that's why I put it on as number 38, because of its configuration. So blue case hardened 1877s are really tough. You don't see a lot of them, let alone a factory engraved example, and then let alone a Kuno Helfrich factory engraved example to this degree. Deluxe engraved in every ounce of the word, from the barrel down to the recoil shield, classic little sun motif on the loading gate itself. I'll flip it around so you can see it. Again, it's not a mint gun, but it's a damn nice gun, and it's a damn rare gun, and it's a price point gun. You can see the blue here on the hammer, but for a blue factory engraved Kuno Helfrich deluxe engraved 1877 Lightning, I challenge you to go find one. Go find one today. You will not be able to do it, let alone for the price point we have this gun at. I think it's like $12,000, $13,000, something like that on the low end. So for a rarity, here it is. For a price point, here it is, and it comes out of a fantastic collection. But number 38 on our list, lot number 59 in your catalogs, the John Fox collection. Number 37 on our list, lot number 431 in your catalogs. I think this gun does a really good job of emphasizing and displaying the depth that is the sale of the century. Here we have the second produced Colt 1903 pocket hammer. It comes out of a fabulous automatic pistol collection, one of the best, if not the finest, in private hands, referencing some guns that we'll talk about a little bit later on, but a Singer, a 1910 Special Army, large U.S. property serial number 22. That is the company that this pocket hammer sat in. Again, it's the second one produced. It's serial number 19,998, going descending. And, you know, again, I just think it does a really good job of emphasizing and displaying the rarity that is this sale. It's not a mint gun, but it's a super high condition gun. It's a super rare gun. It's very well documented in Sheldon's book. Here it is, the second produced 1903 pocket hammer, number 37 on our list, lot number 431 in your catalogs. Number 36 on our list, lot number 3287, another gun representing our fabulous U.S. military collections. And, you know, earlier we're going War of 1812, and it's not often we can associate a gun by history to the War of 1812. Now, it represents a very rare series of guns. These were presented by Congress, and I'll actually just read the presentation on the stock. By a resolve of Congress presented to Smith Bateman for his gallantry at the Siege of Plattsburgh. Samuel Bateman was 16 during the battle. His father was shot down. He picked up a rifle to continue the defense. And you know, the Halls, these were the first guns actually manufactured using interchangeable parts, so kind of a nuance there. But I believe there's one or two of these rifles that are in the Smithsonian. They were actually talking about, there's some history with this gun that was actually intended to be or given to the Smithsonian. That's how rare these guns are. I think there's 10 or 15 of them known that were actually presented by a resolve of Congress, again, to a 16-year-old hero. You can't beat it for history. I do believe we did a special video on this that'll dive a little bit more into that than I will. But again, I wanted to give it its time in the sun. Number 36 in our list, lot number 3287 in your catalogs. Number 35 on our list, number 243 in the catalogs. This is as good as it gets. We're gonna look at some benchmark stuff. We already have looked at some benchmark stuff, and we will as we go down the list. But for pound what this is a benchmark example of a Colt Burgess rifle. And by benchmark, we mean condition. And I just wanna I want to roll this gun so you guys can see it. And this is kind of a nuanced gun in the fact that it has a browned barrel. You know, they only made roughly 3,750 of these Burgess, the Colt Burgess rifles, referencing the gentleman's agreement between Colt and Winchester. But I want to roll it around so you can see the condition. You know, you can feel that wood with your eyes. I want to roll it so you can see the tremendous amount of really bright nitre blue on the bolt, and then that combination finish of blue, nitre, and then case hardening on the hammer. Absolutely spectacular. Again, you can just feel that wood. And then I'll roll it so you can see this side. Kind of the same thing happening. Beautiful nitre blue on the screw heads, tremendous amount of original case hardening on the lever. Beautiful brown. It's a nuance, but it's awesome because it's so rare. You can see the index marking on the barrel, on the frame. I'll roll it so you can see the butt as well. Again, the case hardening's muted, but that's typical, but it's still all there. It's vibrant and flashes. And I'll roll it back down here. This comes out of, I've talked about it and I will talk about it, and hopefully we continue to have the opportunity to work with this collection, but it comes out of a very old time collection, kind of a local collection. But when you start associating these guns, you can see the eye that this collector had, because this is as good as it gets. Listen, we'll be approaching $1 billion in sales here throughout our almost starting, you know, back in the early 90s. This is the finest example of a Burgess that we've seen. And so hopefully when we say that means something, but this is as good as it gets. And that shows you what that collection's all about, put together over 25 or 30 years, as good as it gets. Number 35 on your list, number 243 in your catalogs. Number 34 on our list, lot number 3476. Again, that's gonna be sold Sunday. We've split the military stuff up. It's 3 days. So this is representing the outstanding group of U.S. military firearms. We have specifically 1911s and automatic pistols, split it up over 3 days. We can't not put a Singer on the list. We've made a tradition of continually breaking world record and world record and world record for offering Singers. They've gone up and up and up. They made a finite number of them, as we know, 500 for an educational contract. There is another kind of rare variational foreshadowing that you might see later on in the sale, but this is number 71, I believe. Yes, sir, this is number 71 of the 500 made. Most of them were issued to the Army Air Corps, so like they need little introduction, but we'd be remiss if we didn't add it to the list because they are so rare, they are so scarce. I relate it to the Walkers. We went so long without selling one because they're scarce. And this is kind of a price point gun. This is not going to be a $150,000, $200,000 gun. Here's your opportunity to acquire one at a relatively reasonable price point, and it's a damn fine gun. Number 34 on your list, lot number 3476. Number 33 on our list, lot number 248. Here's a special gun, factory engraved, factory gold inlaid by Kuno Helfrich. It's blued, it's gold washed, carved factory pearl grips. This gun, I believe, holds the distinction as the longest gold inlaid inscription on a pre-war Colt. But we can see here, presented to Captain Fred A. Lamb by his gun club friends, Kansas City, Missouri, 1898. It's antique, and again, this is kind of Helfrich at his finest. Absolutely deluxe. And the condition. So you have condition, rarity, and anytime we can talk about factory gold inlay on a factory engraved Colt, you're in rarefied air, let alone when we have the condition, we have the documentation to back. And this gun is, I believe, in both Colt engraving, if not, certainly the last edition of Colt engraving. Again, Kuno Helfrich, factory engraved, carved factory pearl, gold, blue, number 33 on our list, lot number 248 in your catalogs. Number 32 on our list, lot number 1477 in your catalogs, representing the group of Class 3 NFA weapons in the sale. I'm going to show you a Thompson you can't refuse. As used in the filming of The Godfather, We don't get to see guns like this too often. I mean, there's movie guns and there's movie guns, and that's what this is. You see prop guns, but to have a registered 1921 Thompson that you can watch on the silver screen, one of the most iconic movies of all time, man, find a better one. Find another one. You can't. So a Thompson you can't refuse. Number 32 on our list, lot number 1477 in your catalogs. Number 31 on our list, number 84 in your catalogs. Let's talk about the Tom Selleck collection. Now, a household name, Mr. Selleck, of course, but that's not how we know him. That's not how I know him. That's not how many gun collectors know him. Mr. Selleck is, you know, not known for his exploits on the silver screen in terms of the antique and collectible gun fraternity. He's known for an absolutely astute eye and a passion for very fine 19th century American firearms, be it Winchesters, Whitney Kennedys, or fine sporting rifles, which we have a selection of Mr. Selleck's fine guns in the sale from his wonderful and world-renowned collection. And here we have probably the finest Winchester 92 Trapper carbine, the 16-inch, in the world. We've sold some great 92s, 94 Trappers. We've never had a 16-inch 92 Trapper this good. And as I'm learning to say more and more, I should just let the camera do the talking for me, because it's a tale of condition. It's a tale of rarity. These guns were, you know, rode hard and put away wet. And so to see one like this, which is virtually mint, is so scarce. I mean, you can feel the wood with your eyes. Look at the butt plate. This gun is not almost there. It is all there. Again, as good as it gets. I'll flip it up so you can see the top of the bolt here. But hey, if you want to own the best 16-inch 92 carbine out of the Selleck collection, here's your shot. The sale of the century. Number 31 on our list, number 84 in your catalogs.